Okay. We have 5 o'clock. I'll call this meeting to order. We'll begin by acknowledging that we are in Treaty 1 territory and the traditional homeland of the Métis Nation. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Board of Adjustment. My name is Ken DeRoche. I'm chair of the board. Other members here this evening are Steve Demings and Vanessa Mulhern. To my right, representing the City of Winnipeg, we have Elise Finnegan and Seema Derez. And to my left, we have Ms. Lisa Hutter, who is Secretary to the Board of Adjustment. After hearing representation in support of and opposition to the applications, we will render our decision. Please note that the Board's decision with respect to these applications may be appealed. Should you wish to appeal, information on how to do so will be included in the order, which will be mailed to all persons registered. The appeal will be held at City Hall at a date and time specified on a new notice that will be placed on the property. Could I have a motion to move the minutes of November 15 be taken, read, and confirmed? Steve, thank you.
Good evening. All persons who wish to speak or receive notice of the board's decision must fill out a public representation form and submit it to me as soon as possible. Copies of this form can be found at the registration table at the top of the stairs. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, the process the board will follow is the applicant will be heard first, followed by those in support of the application, next those registered in opposition are heard, followed by those registered for information. Finally, the applicant may return to speak in rebuttal to comments made. However, no new information is permitted. Please note that when your name is called, it is your opportunity to speak. However, you're not obligated to do so. This is a public hearing process brochure, copies of which are available at the registration table. This brochure contains an overview of the process and other information pertaining to what happens before, during, and after a public hearing. As information, all public hearings are recorded and will be part of the public record. Should you have any questions after the public hearing is concluded, please contact the City Clerk's Department. Item 1 is an application for your variance at 447 Templeton Avenue under file DAV 148410 of 2017C. Mr. Chair, there's a request from the applicant to adjourn this to our December 13th meeting.
Motion. From Steve, all in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Item 2 is an application for a conditional use at 667 Watts Street under file DCU 1645352017C.
Ms. Freer. Hi, could I have a seat at the top, please? Hello.
Hi.
Have a seat, please. And can you give us your name and address for the record, please, sir?
My personal address?
Whatever you've written on here.
I think I wrote a couple of things.
86-110 Baylor Avenue?
Yeah, okay, that's my home address.
Okay, and you're Stan Freer?
I'm Stan Freer.
Okay, and you are representing the applicant, or you are?
Yeah, I'm the pastor.
You're the pastor?
Church.
Okay, very good, sir. The city is recommending approval without conditions. One of the things that was submitted in the report is there is a parking management plan has been submitted for yours. Mr. Freer, there is somebody here from the neighborhood that requires a little bit more information on what you're going to be asking for. So if you give us an idea of what you're asking for here this evening and what you're proposing for the property.
Well, we're asking to be able to use the church or the building as a church for worship. We have a very small group. We had a place way up on Pentland, which was a fairly large building. It was a problem for the older people to get up and down the stairs, the washrooms and that. This is a one level, ground level, so it suited our needs. And so we've applied to purchase it for that. I don't foresee any problems in the parking because with the vehicles we have and the people being dropped off by family and things like that, we're not in need of a huge parking space. We've only, at the maximum, we've had maybe 15 people attend. And with three vehicles, plus there's a bus stop nearby, plus anybody, rather relatives of a couple of the people that attend, drop them off and pick them up.
Okay, that's good. Did you have any questions of this board at this time?
Can't think of any.
Okay. Any questions of the applicant? Okay. We also have a P. Panchi here. Okay.
Yeah, we're in the support.
You're in support, sir? Did you wish to speak?
No.
Okay. And Bunty?
Yes, we're here.
And we have you in support, sir. Did you wish to speak?
No, thank you.
Okay. Is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the application for 667 Watt Street? Would like to speak in opposition? Okay. Mr. Freer, we're going to ask the person who is here for information to come up and ask the questions to see if they got all the information. I'll ask you to come back and answer any questions that they may bring forward. Okay?
Sure.
Okay. So right now we'll speak with listen to Leah.
Yes.
Leah Nomick. Yeah. And your name and address. Hi.
Leah Nomick, and the address is 505 Melbourne Avenue.
Very good.
And I have two questions.
Okay.
Presently, right now, we have a green space in between my property and the proposed church,
okay.
Which I have no problem with. I do have a concern in regards to the upkeep of the green space. I've had to reach out numerous times to the realty office that has, had the for sale sign, asking when the property was going to be maintained as far as cutting grass. And I also have a question about the snow removal. In the past, the insurance company that used to own the property had a snow removal company that would plow the parking lot at 2 and 3 o'clock in the morning and dump the snow next to my property, which caused my crawl space to flood each year.
Okay.
So those are my questions.
Okay, so maintenance of the property, basically.
Yes, exactly.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, winter and summer.
Right.
Because right now, the grass was cut, but the leaves were never taken care of. And as neighbors, I'm kind of representing a lot of the neighbors that couldn't come, the older folks.
Sure.
That had some concerns about leaves blowing. You know, the grass was very high. People tended to use that as a through path, which is fine. But when it wasn't cut, there was some older people that were concerned about falling and things like that.
Okay.
So.
Is there a fence between your property and this?
I have a fence, but the actual fence, the green space, is not fenced. So
In front of the building?
Correct.
Oh, I see.
Well, it's a green space in between, so there's no fence.
Well, there's two trees, right? There's two lilac trees. I'm looking at a plan.
That's right next to the building, but
right.
The green space itself, the fence, our fence, only goes as far as the part of the green space, which is my fence, and then they extended the fence for the parking lot area.
Okay.
Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Next to my parking pad.
Correct. Okay.
Yes.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Anything else?
Nope, that's
okay.
It.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Is there anybody else like to require further information for 667 Watt? No? Okay. And then Mr. Freer, if you'd like to come back up, please. Okay, Mr. Freer, I think you earlier said you were thinking of purchasing. You haven't purchased this property yet, then?
No, certain conditions. That,
right.
And one of them was that we could use it as a church property.
Right. So it might be a bit premature that you haven't obtained any contracts with anybody to do yard maintenance.
Not
or
a finalized
snow removal.
One. We put a deposit to hold until we could see the final outcome.
Right.
And then we were going to purchase it if everything was okay.
Okay, and in your eyes, at this time, do you see any problem with maintaining the property to an acceptable level that the neighbors would not be upset with you at this time?
I see no. The place we came from, we paid somebody to cut the lawn that we had. That area she's referring to actually has nothing to do with us. That's a residential area, as I understand, where they can build a house or something like that. Any land that we have would be up around the lilacs on the other side, as I understand it. I haven't gone out and measured it, but
okay.
As I understand it, that open area, that's not anything to do with us. We had the parking lot area measured by an architect, and we realize that we really only have half the space approximately. Up to the edge of our building is our area on the parking lot. The rest would belong to whoever the residential people that would be there. We also paid for somebody to clean our parking lot, but we never ever had anybody get up at 3 o'clock in the morning, 2 o'clock in the morning, and move snow at our other lot. It was always looked after.
Okay. City's looking at me. You've got something to say?
I just wanted to clarify a point that after the report was completed, we found out that this is actually two lots, as you can see in the zoning assessment layer. It's not registered in IVU yet because the subdivision is still underway.
Okay.
It's nearly completed. So the eastern half is in fact a lot two that is going to be a separate lot.
I see.
It's a commercial lot. It's not a residential lot, so it's not up to us to say what will happen here, unfortunately.
I see.
So it is the west half of the lot that is under scrutiny right now. That's what we're looking at today.
Okay.
And as for the concerns brought forward about the snow removal and the maintenance of the green space,
right,
we do have a livability bylaw.
Okay.
And if neighbors would like to call 311, they can certainly, there would be bylaw enforcement.
Okay. But it sounds like Mr. Freer said that they already have purchased or hired for other snow removal, so I'm assuming it'll happen again.
Yeah.
Okay. So.
But that's only part of the lot by the sounds of it.
Yeah.
So.
There'll be a vacant lot beside
that,
you.
That wasn't my understanding.
Yeah.
Originally it was the whole location.
Yeah. Now you know.
Yeah.
It's not them.
So is that other parcel still for sale or?
Well, it's got to be subdivided first, I think. I think the city said they're going through subdivision.
No, it's not complete yet.
It's not completed yet. So.
And that's a given that it will be subdivided?
Can
we
speak
on
this application
to explain? No, not now, sir.
So if it's underway, I understand that there weren't concerns brought forward regarding the subdivision, and that is being processed, so before it's registered in land titles.
Okay.
And do the neighbors get a say in?
Well, that's not something up for discussion right now.
Okay.
You'll have an opportunity when it gets subdivided, and if there's another yellow posting, you can talk to her after.
Okay.
That's good, sir. Thank you very much for your time. Okay, who's starting off? Vanessa. Okay. Concerning conditional use, DCU 164535 2017 C667 Watt Street. Assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied, what is the will of the board? And it'll be Vanessa.
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Post carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried.
That in accordance with Section 254 and Subsection 247 Sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the conditional use is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Post carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the conditional use be approved as applied for.
All in favor? Post carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried. Seema, do you have a business card you can give her? So you don't have to wait till the end of the meeting. Give her a phone call tomorrow if you want.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
Item 3 is an application for a conditional use at 556 St. Anne's Road under file DCU 168857 of 2017C. In accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw, this is a combined hearing, and the following item will also be heard at the same time. Item 4 is an application for a variance at 556 St. Anne's Road under file DAV 168822 of 2017C.
Okay. Aaron? Aaron?
Yes.
Hi. And your name and address, please, sir.
Yeah, it's Aaron Samoes, and I'm at 300-214 McDermott.
Okay, so for the conditional use, the city is recommending approval subject to one condition. Have you read that condition?
Yes, I have.
That would be 2 years to establish, right?
Mm-hmm.
And for the variance, the city is recommending the same one condition. And this is going to, you're asking for, it's going to be 5 years?
Yes.
Up to 5 years?
Yeah.
Okay. Any questions of the board at this time?
No.
Any questions of the applicant?
No.
Is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the applications for 556 St. Anne's Road? Speak in opposition or require further information? No? Good. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Concerning conditional use, DCU 168857 2017C, 556 St. Anne's Road. Assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied, what is the will of the board? I'll be Steve.
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor, opposed, carry.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor, opposed, carry.
I move that in accordance with Section 254 and Subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the conditional use is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I concur with the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken, be concurred in, and the conditional use be approved subject to one condition.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed, carried. Concerning variance DAV 168822-2017C, 556 St. Anne's Road, assuming all statutory requirements in regard to this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board?
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with the Plan of Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is a minimum modification of the zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I concur with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in, and that the variance be approved subject to one condition.
All in favor? Opposed, carried. Got it. Finish it off.
Sorry, I move to the public hearing with respect to this application to be concluded.
All in favor? Most carried. Thank you.
Item 5 is an application for a variance at 1680 Sargent Avenue under file DAV 171412-2017C.
Larry or Lanny? And can we have your name and address, please, sir?
Lanny Silver, with Lanny Silver Architect. My address is 437 Assiniboine Avenue.
Okay, so the city is recommending approval subject to three conditions. Have you read those conditions?
I have.
Any issues or concerns with those?
None.
No, okay. Any questions of this board at this time?
None.
Any questions of the applicant? No. Okay, we have Jay Kanish here. Jay? Okay, we have you in support, sir. Did you wish to speak? No? Okay. Is there anybody else here who would like to speak in support of the application for 1680 Sargent Avenue? Speak in opposition or require further information? No? Okay. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Concerning variance DAV 171412-2017C, 1680 Sargent Avenue, assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? It'll be Vanessa.
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Opposed, carry.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed, carry.
That in accordance with subsection 247 sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. Is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in, and the variance be approved subject to three conditions.
All in favor? Opposed, carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed, carried. Oh. Oh. Why don't we wait till the end? Yeah, we're going to... Okay, just let the board know. Item 6, the applicant isn't here, so we're going to put this one to the end in case they come in late.
Item 7 is an application for a variance at 1300 Aberdeen Avenue under file DAV 173197 of 2017C.
And name and address, please.
Lindsay Oster with Prairie Architects at 101 139 Market.
Good. And the city is recommending approval subject to 3 conditions. Have you read those conditions?
I have, yes.
Have you any issues or concerns with those?
No.
Any questions for the board?
No.
Any questions for the applicant? Okay, is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the application for 1300 Aberdeen? Speak in opposition or require further information? Okay. Thank you. concerning variance, DAV 173197-2017C, 1300 Aberdeen Avenue. Assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? And it'll be Steve.
Move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor, opposed, carried.
Move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor, opposed, carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. Does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including the area separated from the property by a street or waterway, is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I concur with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
And move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be incurred in and the variance be approved subject to 3 conditions.
All in favor? Post carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried.
Item 8 is an application for a conditional use at 577 Gateway Road under file DCU 166646 of 2017C in accordance with the City of Winnipeg Charter and the Development Procedures Bylaw. This is a combined hearing. The following item will also be heard at the same time. Item 9 is an application for a variance at 577 Gateway Road under file DAV 166658 of 2017C.
Is the applicant, please? Brendan?
I have a short presentation.
Okay.
Got on a laptop here.
Okay. We'll start off with your name and address, please, sir.
Brendan Salico, 298 Waterfront Drive.
Thank you. Okay, sir, you'll have 10 minutes to go through your presentation.
Okay. All right. Well, thanks a lot.
Mm-hmm.
So just an overview. I'll speak to who we are, what we'd like to do, the planning context, our planning process, our development application, and finally, the development concept. So my name, again, is Brendan Salico. I'm here for Landmark Planning and Design, and we've been retained by the owner of 577 Gateway to lead a planning process and a stakeholder engagement process. We're seeking conditional use as well as some minor variances so that the property can eventually be developed as a fourplex. So just in terms of the site context, again, it's at 577 Gateway Road. There's an existing home on site built in the early 20s. The lot's approximately 5,300 square feet. It's zoned R2, and it's located at the corner of Gateway and Moncton. In terms of the local context, this site, as well as all the sites on the blocks and the adjacent blocks, are zoned as R2, or residential two-family. The site is very well served by transit, with two routes in close vicinity, and the future BRT corridor, bus rapid transit corridor, across the street. In terms of the R Winnipeg context, this area is designated as a mature community, which are generally communities that have been planned before 1950, have a variety of housing types and a full range of community amenities. These areas, according to the plans, as well as complete communities, note that they offer some of the best opportunities for infill type development. Just kind of digging further into some of those and some of those policies in both our Winnipeg and Complete Communities. These are areas that can support a range of housing options to accommodate different life cycle, different stages of life, different various income levels, promote a more compact urban form, enable the intensification of land uses, minimize the spatial use of land, and support contextually sensitive infill development, which we feel this is here. In terms of our public consultation and stakeholder engagement process, we always start off with meeting the planning department as well as a representative from zoning, a zoning officer, to understand what the city's thoughts are in terms of policy and in terms of local context. We meet with the zoning officer to understand if there might be any potential variances that we hadn't thought of. In terms of stakeholder engagement, at our firm, we always try to reach out to adjacent residents and nearby residents prior to making any type of application. So we invited all the adjacent residents on the block, as well as across the back lane and on the two cross streets, Moncton and Government, to a meeting which we hosted on August 30th. At this meeting, we had two attendees, both from a home on Moncton, just across the lane, where we introduced our planning process, our timeline, some general planning concepts, as well as our anticipated next steps. We did receive input from those neighbors. There were two concerns in particular that that did come up, which was snow clearing. There was concerns that because of the way the parking would be set up, that they would be dumping snow on their yard and potentially driving on their yard. So those were the two main concerns. We worked with the landowner to try to address those concerns as best we could. He's committed to snow clearing. He does own snow clearing equipment himself and would either be doing it himself or hiring a contractor to do that. He's also committed to either supporting a fence or bollards and contributing to those financially to mitigate both those concerns, again, the snow and potential for people who are trying to turn into parking, driving on the lawn. So we did commit to following up on those concerns, and we feel we did. We haven't heard back from those residents. In terms of our application, again, it's a conditional use to allow a fourplex on the site, and then variances, front yard setback reduction, buffer for the building and parking area, or a reduced buffer between the parking area and the back lane as well. And those variances are essentially just required due to the awkward shape of the lot, as most river lots are. It's kind of a skewed angle, so it's difficult to fit a square or building at 90 degrees on that without going into the yards. We also committed to a bungalow design, a one-story design versus two stories, which would be more typical for a site like this. But of course, concerns like density or I should say more height and privacy often come up. So it was committed to building or to proposing a single-story design. And then again, parking off the lane. So just in terms of site plan, here's what is being proposed. Fourplex on the site, again, single story. Landscaping and fencing both go above and beyond city requirements. We were able to preserve two mature trees in the front yard along Gateway Road, and then parking along the back lane, which would be common for a lot of these infill projects in existing built-up neighborhoods. And then finally, just some preliminary elevations for the concept. So that's it. Thank you very much. And
Did you mention that this concern about the snow?
Yeah.
Did you? And he owns a business, or he hires a business to?
He owns equipment like a bobcat and a trailer to move snow.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So that was my next question. Is the snow going to be pushed, or is it going to be removed? At this time, do you even know that?
Most likely removed, yeah. Removed. Yeah, from the site.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you. We do have people here from 619, which is the property you've been referring to,
yep,
through your presentation. They are here this evening, so we'll give them an opportunity to come up.
Perfect.
For answers, I'll call you back up,
yep,
and you can answer any of their concerns, but only their concerns that they brought up, nothing new.
For sure.
Okay. And at this time, we also have somebody in support of the application. It's Sylvester. Sylvester, sir, we have you in support. Yeah? Did you wish to speak, sir?
No.
Is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the application for 577 Gateway Road? No? Okay.
We'll go to those in opposition. That'll be Terry and Ronnie Beach.
Hello.
I'm Terry. That's Ronnie.
Hi. And yeah, your name is
Beach. 619 Moncton Avenue.
Thank you very much. Go ahead, sir.
We live right across the lane from this property.
Right.
It is a small property. As you can see, it's only 800 square feet, the house that is there now.
Right.
And we think this property is far too small, especially for six parking spots at the back, which is going to hit right into our property. We all know that it already is being driven on now. And there's already been people throwing snow in our yard. And as far as I knew, when I built my house on our property 10, 11 years ago, they told us we had to be 5 feet from our property line, and now they're saying they only need 4. And that was one of the city's concern to me, because it was being a corner property, you have to maintain 5 feet from the property line.
Okay, city?
For your corner side yard?
Yes. And I've seen that on other sites for different places. On a corner yard, you need 5 feet from the property line, 4 feet from an infill line.
Well, she's got the book, so we'll wait for her answer.
Sure.
Okay.
Because it's not part of the, or is it part of the variance?
No, it's not part of the variance.
No.
So your property is zoned R1, so your corner side yard would be 4 feet.
I was told 5 feet from the lane, because it's a corner lot. And I've seen that on a number of different things, even through the zoning department. Corner lots need 5 feet on that side, on a public lot.
No, it's 4 feet in the R1.
Oh, so I was lied to. When I built my house, they tried to move my house.
Yeah, it may have been.
When I was trying to build it.
Yeah, I'm not sure. When did you inquire about that?
Well, I built my house 12 years ago.
Yeah, it could have been under a different zone.
So that's not an issue anymore, apparently. As far as their parking goes, like, they're awfully close to their house. I believe a CO2 problem, because I also work in the autopsy department, and I see a lot of people dying because of fires and CO complaints. So I don't think that's right. They even talk about bus rapid transit here. We don't know what's going to happen with bus rapid transit there. To remove the front yard from this yard could be an issue. There's still a lot of mystery going on with that.
Well, the city is recommending approval, so the
so this
of
is
that
a said done
isn't in the foremost in their mind.
And I do have a concern with the snow being thrown out. And they're talking about it, like they're going to remove it. What if they get tired of this place and sell it? Who's going to guarantee that's going to happen to the next owners?
Well, there's no guarantees in life, right?
Exactly. So it's just going to be snow being thrown on either the lane or my yard.
I can't answer about the future, sir.
And just who's cutting all the grass around there? Not on there, but there's lots of property of the boulevards around. They don't even have room for a shed in there.
Well, we can assume that the property owner will be responsible for the care and well-being of the property. And as the city mentioned earlier in the previous property, if the previous property we heard, if there is an issue with maintenance.
And I have complained. Yeah. And it falls on deaf ears. I already have a problem with my corner, because my corner of my property is on two back lanes. So the garbage trucks like to run over my property. I've put a pole there. They bent it. They broke it. I've called the city. They guaranteed they're going to fix it. And then that fell on deaf ears again. So I still have a broken pole. And the city isn't taking care of it. And they just drag it out until winter comes along. So I'm going to have annoying on that back corner. And I'm going to have this next property annoying me on the front corner. So I consider it adverse effects on my property. But that will be up to you.
Okay. Okay. Thank you for your time, sir. Is there anybody else like to speak in opposition to the property at 577 Gateway Road? No. Okay. I don't know if you and for anybody for requires further information? No. Brendan? Okay. You guys got any questions at all? What's going on? You good?
Just no? How big are the units?
I
not sure why the report is, because the map, the plans are all grayed out. I don't know.
Yeah, it's hard to see them. Yeah, I'm not quite sure. It might be a question for Brendan, because I don't have
it. But what's the significance of the question?
I just want to understand the density on the site.
Okay. Brendan, if you want to come back. Brendan?
It's like around 100.
Oh. The only question I think we can answer this time is the square footage of the units?
So they'd be 1,200 approximately up and down.
Oh, because of...
Okay. I don't think there was anything else you can address that was asked by the Mr. and Mrs. Beach at this time, because they were talking more in the future. But if you have a comment on anything there?
Sure, yeah. Just, again, to reiterate the comments before regarding the snow clearing. Again, the landowner is committed to removing the snow, whether himself or through a contractor. And the offer is always standing to contribute to a fence or bollards to mitigate those two issues that they seem to have a major concern about. So.
Okay, and who would they contact if it was a...
They can contact me directly. Yeah.
Years from now.
Then the landowner himself.
Okay, is that information available to them?
I believe it's on the planning report. Yeah, okay. It's the owner. Yeah.
Okay, so they'll have to get that information from the city then.
Uh huh.
Okay, thanks for your time, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay. I'm sorry, is it Vanessa?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Concerning conditional use, DCU 16666. 2017C, 577 Gateway Road, assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? And Vanessa?
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Post carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried.
That in accordance with Section 254 and Subsection 247 Sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the conditional use is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan, does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Post carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the conditional use be approved subject to one condition.
Conditional use is one?
Yes.
Oh, yeah. Okay. All in favor? Post carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Carried. Concerning variance DAV 166658 2017C 577 Gateway Road, assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board?
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Post carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried.
That in accordance with subsection 247 sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. Is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Post carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved as applied for.
All in favor? Post carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried. Thank you.
There's number 10.
We'll go to number 11.
Item 11 is an application for a variance at 54 Crystal Avenue under file DAV 170038 of 2017C.
Do we have Mr. Singh here? Hi. And your name and address, please, sir?
My name is Amandeep Singh, and address is 33 Sorokin Street.
Thank you. And the city is recommending approval subject to seven conditions. You've read those conditions?
Yes, I have.
Have any issues or concerns?
No issues.
Any questions of this board?
No.
Any
totally
questions
agree.
Of the applicant? No. Is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the application for 54 Crystal Avenue? Speak in opposition or require further information? Oh, okay. I think you have the next one too, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, concerning a variance, DAV 17003827 C, 54 Crystal Avenue, assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? And go to Steve.
I move that the report of the, oops, there you go. We got a fade out there. I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Post carry.
I move that the receipt of public representation be concluded.
All in favor? Post carry.
Move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with the plan of Winnipeg, Plan Winnipeg, and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including the area separated from the property by a street or waterway, and is the minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Post carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in, and that the variance be approved subject to 7 conditions.
All in favor? Post carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried. Okay, number 12.
Number 12 is an application for a variance at 52 Matheson Avenue East under file DEV 17008.
You need my address again, please.
Amandeep Singh, and the address is 33 Sorokin Street.
Okay. And the city is recommending approval subject to 5 conditions. Have you read those 5 conditions?
Yes, I have.
Have you any issues or concerns with
those? No concerns.
Any questions of this board?
Not at all.
Any questions of the applicant? Okay. Mr. Singh, we do have somebody who has filed an opposition, so I'll let you know that. Yeah. Is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the variance for 52 Matheson Avenue East? No? Okay. Sir, we'll have those that come up and speak in opposition, and you have an opportunity to address their issues. Okay? And we have Mitchell Gotch.
Gotch? Yeah. I just have some questions mainly.
Okay, can we first have your name and address,
yeah,
please?
Mitchell Gatch, 56 Matheson Avenue East.
Very good. Go ahead, please, sir.
Yeah, so I'm the neighbor. I live right next to there.
Okay.
Right now the house is a pretty rundown house, and I do agree with them tearing it down and building a new house. Okay. I think that the lot's pretty small to build 2 houses on there. I do have some questions. Mainly regarding the trees. There's big trees in the yard. It provides lots of privacy to my yard, and Winnipeg's tree canopy is invaluable. The trees, they make the neighborhood very special, and the environmental benefits and privacy they provide my property is one of the main reasons I live there. I was looking, I think 10 of the 17 lots on the south, on my side of Matheson are larger lots with larger character homes, including the lot to the east of lot 93. I have some concerns about my fence and the foundation damage that can occur when building. I have concerns about parking. Like, are they going to be building 2 parking lots back there, which would reduce? I have concern about reduced parking on the street. That'll inconvenience people living on the street. And I also have questions if it's going to be used as a rental property too, because the neighborhood is full of families that have roots there. And renters usually tend to move on after the lease is up. So I do have some questions too, some more. If approved, each lot would only have a single family home, therefore a duplex would not be permitted. Can this can be confirmed? Can you guys confirm that?
A duplex would not be permitted. They don't have enough lot area to.
Okay. Will the removal of the trees be approved?
We don't have any authority to regulate trees on private property.
Okay.
So we cannot make any guarantees around that. That's up to the property owner.
And he'll answer the question?
Yeah.
Sure.
Let's see here. How close can the house be built on the property line to my property?
3 feet.
3 feet?
Is the minimum side yard.
Okay. All right. Can the city restrict the placement of air conditioners, HVACs, as well as cantilevers on the other side of the house from my house? If it's going to be 3 feet away from my house, I was...
Like projections?
No, like can the air conditioner be on the other side of the house? Like, I have a neighbor right now with an air conditioner on the side of my house, and it's just blast. It's really loud.
We are recommending plan approval. That could possibly be something that could be considered.
Okay. All right. Will the development allow for parking off the back lane?
Was that the answer?
Will the development allow for parking off the back lane?
Likely.
Yeah.
I don't believe there's any front drive approaches allowed. No. No front approaches shall be permitted as part of the conditions.
Okay. Is this going to affect my property tax at all?
No.
No? Okay. All right. That's just the questions I have, mainly for the applicant.
Okay. So, first of all, to answer one of your questions, rental or owner occupied, we don't dictate who they're going to build, and if they're marketable, they'll be sold. If they're not marketable to be sold, they would be rented. But we don't have any control of what they people do with their own homes.
Understandable, yeah.
Okay. So right now we're looking at the trees and parking to be...
And mainly my fence foundation just being...
Right. Okay, that's the other thing, sir. We always recommend that property owners such as here that construction is going next door to call the contractor in, have a look at your home to ensure that there aren't any cracks or problems with the foundation. We recommend that you take pictures with date stamps on them.
Mm-hmm.
So if there is any problem that it does occur, which is not likely, everybody seems to be so careful with their construction these days, at least you'll have some photographic evidence to show that damage was caused, and then that'll be brought forward to them.
Okay,
so that's important that you take pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we'll call the applicant back up.
Sure.
Okay, at this time, is there anybody requiring additional information for 52 Matheson Avenue East? No? Okay. Okay, Mrs. Singh. Okay, so we know that there's no garage. You can't build garages on attached to the homes. So what is your plan for parking behind these two homes, please, sir?
Yeah, there will be a parking space at the back of the property because there's no front approach anyway. And I think each lot can, because these are very long lots.
Right.
So even with the house built, each house can easily have few cars parked at the back.
Okay.
So I guess that will reduce the traffic on the street.
Right. So it's going to be a concrete pads you're going to be pouring for them, or whatever it is at the time?
Probably not pads, just a graveled pad.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And secondly is the trees that are on the west side of the property.
Trees, for the plan, like I haven't submitted the plans yet,
right,
but I'll try to cut down the minimum trees. But I think on that lot I have to cut down a few trees for the construction.
Yeah, for 25 foot.
Definitely, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
But I'll try to save as much as I can, because obviously cutting each tree costs us more, you know, so
sure,
we keep our costs down. So.
And when you build the houses, are you considering putting in air conditioning at that time?
If I do, I can put it at the back.
Okay.
So it doesn't have to be necessarily on the side. It can go at the back.
Okay.
Yeah, and I have worked as a supervisor in a construction company, and we normally prefer those air conditions and the sump pit pipes to go at the back.
Yeah, it makes sense.
On a 25-foot lot, because they got a very less space on the side anyway if person have to walk on the side.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great.
Unless it's something that doesn't suit the design or something, then might as well sometimes they go on the back, but we prefer on the side, but we prefer to go on the back.
Okay. Plan approval is required on one of your number five of the conditions, so the city will review that too.
Yes.
Okay, thanks for your time, sir.
Thank you very much.
Okay, concerning variance DAV 17008827C, 52 Matheson Avenue East, assuming all statutory requirements in regard to this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? I'll be Vanessa.
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Post carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Post carried.
That in accordance with subsection 247 sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved subject to five conditions.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Okay.
Item 13 is an application for a variance at 456 Bannatyne Avenue under file DAV 174104 of 2017C. Members of the committee, please note there's a communication submitted after the agenda was published in opposition and in support of this application.
Thank you. Mr. Rodriguez.
Let's put this up. I guess it's good.
Yep. Can you turn off that light?
Yeah.
Okay, can we start with your names and address for the record, please, gentlemen?
Yeah. Ali Rodriguez, 610 Broadway. I'm the applicant and the architect on the project.
Thank you.
Tony Texera from JMT Holdings. I'm the owner of the property and the owner of the development.
Okay. To begin with, we have received communication, one from the area councillor in support of the development, but has asked that plan approval be reviewed by Lord Selkirk West Kildonan Committee to go to them after. And then another letter on that we received from Mr. I think it was. I'm sorry? Was it Catherine? Yeah, Catherine Collins, who was filed in opposition, and the board has had an opportunity to review both of these letters prior to the hearing. Along with that, we do have a couple of people who have registered in opposition to your proposal. Okay, so at this time, I'll ask you to kind of give an idea of what you're asking for, what your development's going to entail, so they have a better understanding of what's going on here this evening. Okay, it's all yours, sir.
Okay, so basically we're asking for a residential multi-use. So we have 26 units, apartment units, and we have on main level a small commercial space, which at the time of the application we needed to add a use to it. So after conversations with the owners, it was decided that perhaps a good application and to bring some activity to the street level would be to do a coffee shop to service the tenants and the immediate neighbors. This is not what you think of as a full-out restaurant that goes all night and sells alcohol at all times of the day and hour and night. So that's not our intent at all whatsoever. And at the same time, having, you can see on the design, I don't know if you can see from there, mostly it's all glazing. So the idea was to actually create a transparency so that the tenants that are inside the restaurant or the coffee shop could actually have a direct view of the street. So by having that, it will prevent people from gathering outside and conduct criminal activity, as been suggested by the opposition. So as you can see, so both corners, they're completely glazing. So there are patios on there, and it's the intent, again, is to bring people to the actual street to, and by doing that, prevent other activities from occurring. The intent is obviously at night, and you can see from these renderings, but there's actually a step back. Mm-hmm. So there's basically what we call soft lighting, so they'll be very lit. So all the way along that sidewalk on both streets, at night time would be excellently lit, like where people would be, I'd say, afraid of conducting any criminal activity because they'll be exposed. Because to the tenants that are in the building and from the neighbors that are across the street, they would be viewable. So that's we do have parking. It's enclosed inside the building. It's not underground, but it's enclosed inside the building. And again, the tenant market that we're going, that we think will be living in this building, it would be probably students at Red River and from the science, Elde Science campus, so within walking distance, so the need for vehicle is going to be limited. So therefore, again, and the idea that the restaurant is to service and to be geared for the tenants, there's not going to be an influx of extra vehicles coming in to take up street parking.
Just wanted to add a little bit to that. Back a few years back, we had submitted a similar proposal, however, without a commercial element to it. It wasn't my intent not to make the Residents Association aware of this. I actually have reached out to Ms. Collins regarding this, and actually sent her the renderings ahead of time after she had called for me, and really it was a little bit of miscommunication between Elio and myself, and we did not get the information out. We want to be in cooperation with that, and I've informed her that we definitely want to be transparent, and we're not trying to hide anything here. One thing that I did want to point out is due to the numerous units in here that normally a facility like this does have a common area, whether it be a multi-purpose room or a meeting room or whatever you choose to be. And I think one of the ideas behind being able to have a coffee shop there was to be able to utilize this as that type of common area, but and at the same time utilizing the space in order for a viable business in order to operate there. I think it was in discussions with LU and the planner, I think it was brought up by the planner that given the zoning being mixed use, that they would like to see some activity and some commercial use on the ground floor, and I think it's a good use of the space. Having said that, I've made it very clear that to the both Residents Association and to Ms. Leslie Spillett, that is our neighbor from Kanigachuk, that I'm willing to sit down with them and discuss all their concerns, and as far as we're concerned, we're very confident that part of our focus is having people from, nurses, doctors, whoever, from Health Sciences Center or students from the Red River campus, but also immigrant families from, because we do have some bigger units as well, and new Canadians and whatever the case may be. So I think we'll have a very good mix of different types of people, and I think that commercial area will be utilized quite well.
Okay, so main floor will be commercial and parking, and residential starts on the second level?
Correct.
Okay, very good. Okay. Anything else, gentlemen?
I think that's it.
That's it? Okay. Again, we'll ask those who have filed an opposition to come up, and you can address any issues that they bring forward, okay? At this time, is there anybody else who would like to speak in support of the application for 456 Vanatine? Okay, we'll go to those in opposition. And we have Catherine Collins here. Oh, yeah. Yes, we did. Yeah, we got that.
So I hope you can hear
me. Your name and address for the record, please.
My name is Catherine Collins. I'm a resident at 460 McDermott Avenue, and I'm the president of the McDermott Sherbrooke Residents Association, Inc. I'm here on behalf of the members of the West Alexander Residents Association. I'm here on behalf of the members of the West Alexander Residents Association. Our organization was founded in November 2006. Chief among our concerns is to safeguard the community for its residents. A number of our members, including myself, Fred Curry, and Harold Martinez, who are here, were involved in creating the secondary plan for Centennial West Alexander. As Tony has stated, we did work with him several years ago when he was developing a proposal for housing at 454-456 Bannatyne, but it did not proceed because of lack of funding. His proposal at that time was only for housing. We met with him a number of times and even went in to support his presentation to the province. I want to state that we do support housing in our neighborhood if it is well maintained and safe. However, the reason I'm here in opposition is because there are elements of this application that I'm concerned about on the basis of safety concerns, and I'll give you the context for that. I've lived in the area for 30 years, one block from this property. Just to fill you in on the neighborhood, there's a lot of adverse businesses in the immediate area. You've got them listed in your presentation, the Balmoral Hotel, the Aquarius Bathhouse. These are open 7 days of the week, late into the evening. Behind my own house, there's a vacant piece of property at 55 Isabel that has been a site for the last 20 years for drinking, sleeping, drug use, and dumping. And we've tolerated this. But condoms and needles accumulate, and children are exposed to this. There has been a lot of crime in this area, and sadly, I have to report that I was broken into while I was in my house sleeping last summer. My own garden shed has been ripped open twice this year and things stolen. Frequently, cars of people who attend the bathhouse are broken into and their valuables are scattered about the neighborhood in my backyard, and they include some items that I've listed there. So when I saw this application, I didn't have much time. I went out and I canvassed the residents living around the site of the proposed building, as well as the bakery across the street. Everyone I spoke to shared the same concerns for safety, based on two aspects of the building's design: the patios on Bannatyne and Harriet, and the restaurant use. No one I spoke to envisioned using the restaurant. In regard to the patios, there is a concern that people who do not live in the building will use these patios for drinking, partying, sex, drug use, and meeting places for pickups. And in spite of the lighting, it will be worse at night. Secondly, we cannot see how bringing a restaurant into the interior of a primarily residential area will help with neighborhood safety. Unfortunately, restaurants and their washrooms can provide cover for other things like drug use, selling stolen goods, and sex. At the start, it may have no license to sell liquor, but there is no guarantee that once it's there, the license application may not be made. Restaurants and their washrooms can provide cover for many things, as I stated. So I've just put a little note there. We are concerned about any licensing because bringing liquor into an area does mean that there's more violence and violent crimes. I've listed some references there. So even an ordinary restaurant in our neighborhood can have a negative effect. An example is the new Tim Hortons on Isabel that is now a site for drug sales and shoot-ups in the washroom. And the police can verify this. The staff at the Central Neighborhood Development Corporation used to pick up needles daily in the lane behind Tim Hortons. And just for those of you not familiar with the site on Bannatyne, for the restaurant and patios, there are two daycares within one block, and there's also Victoria Albert School one block away. As we've heard, this area shares a boundary with Ganiganichik, which is a center for counseling, health, culturally based activities, and employment training for Indigenous people, especially for youth. So we need to protect our young people. Now, I've listed the conditions which you review, as you state them every time in the meeting, and I don't agree that this will not create an adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the property and the adjacent areas. And I don't think it's necessarily fully compatible with the area in which it's situated. I've quoted some things from the City of Winnipeg Act as well. So on the basis of safety and adverse effects, the design for this building does pose a safety risk. The patio areas need to be redesigned for the safety of the surrounding residents and the residents in the building. And some other purpose needs to be found for the space called the restaurant at present. You don't need commercial zoning to have a common area in your building. So I've suggested some alternate uses. Another daycare would be welcome, particularly if you're having young families in the building, a senior center, or some kind of trading center. So in conclusion, I would ask that these two aspects of the application be declined, if that's possible. And we're prepared to meet with the applicant and the architect to work together with our resident group on a proposal that is totally good for the area. So I hope Ganiganichik will also join us with that. So, Tony, I hope you forgive me for listing all these things, but I needed some background.
Okay. I'd like to ask the city, does the zoning's permitted this commercial operation on the main floor?
R2.
It is permitted. I should just note that the PDO, the West Alexander PDO, does actually restrict certain uses in the PDO. But a restaurant use is not one of them. So within the residential mixed-use area, the following uses are either permitted, conditional, accessory, or temporary uses, which is the expansion of single-room occupancy, drinking establishment, surface parking as a principal use, and craft brewery, distillery, or winery.
Is permitted or not?
Is not permitted.
Not permitted, okay.
Yeah. So restaurant is...
But so there would be, there aren't any ideas coming forward with liquor license for this property then? They're not allowed?
Well, no.
Or would they have to apply, I would imagine.
They have to apply. That's right. That's regulated by the province. So,
right.
Yeah.
Right.
And okay. It's accessed, like it's tied to the food sales. And
right. Okay. Okay. Thanks for your time, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Next we have H. Martinez.
Yeah, I don't need to speak. I'm here.
You're in opposition,
yeah.
Sir. Okay, thank you, sir. And then we have Fred Curry.
I'm very brief.
Okay.
I covered everything I've written.
Okay. And if you could give us your name and the address for the record, please, sir.
Fred Curry at 997 Dorchester Avenue.
Very good. Go
ahead. I don't live in the area, but I've got lots of friends, and I've worked in the neighborhood for a long time. And just with respect to if they ask for a liquor license, it's a conditional use in the zoning. Like if, and the zoning, I believe, is probably R2, but the RMU is an overlay. That's a PDO. Right. It's the plan development overlay that was done, seven or eight years ago. And so it allows for a drinking establishment as a commercial use, but it's a conditional use they'd have to apply for. And if they do, I mean, the restaurant, what Kathy said about the restaurant is true. When you've got, if you check the restaurants in the neighborhood, there's very little you can do about them to protect people from the activities that go on in them, because there's a lot of, it's not just the bars and the bathhouse down on Notre Dame that are problems. There are other uses in other parts of the area that generate a lot of drug and traffic and sex business. And they use public facilities, if you have a restaurant that's accessible to the public, you're gonna have people, and especially, there's a lot of violence down around Notre Dame, around the restaurant and around the bars and everything like that. People look for areas that are a bit away from it to protect themselves. And so, a restaurant is refuge. There used to be a Tim Hortons down in Notre Dame that closed because you couldn't get into the washrooms there because of the prostitutes having sex in the washrooms. They were banging the doors when you go in. You'd have to knock your door into them. So there's a lot of that going on. So, the only thing that would count, quote, as a restaurant, unquote, that might be useful would be if they have residents who want to have kind of a cafeteria. Like if you're going to have seniors in the building, it's good to have, eating for them that's available as a cafeteria basis. But if you're having access to the public of people who are not living in the building, you're going to be attracting the drug, sex, and alcohol. And one of the other things that people use those public places for cover is for stolen goods and stuff. Because, you sell stolen goods the same way you sell drugs. They do that in the public places, too, because the traffic that comes in and go provides cover for them, and that's why they do it. So the restaurant is not safe. And as Kathy was pointing out, the patio outside, allowing people to go outside, the people who want to do business with the drugs and traffic and sex will use the outside, and after hours, you should see what goes on in the side lots and the parking and some people's backyards if you talk to some of the people in the neighborhood. So what I would want to say to you, if there is liable to be a drinking establishment, there are a lot of kids in that neighborhood using a school. If you had children or grandchildren, would you want them going by a place where there might be people sitting outdoors and drinking in a neighborhood like that with the stuff that's going to go on in that place? Not safe. Not safe. So, it'd be good to, we worked years ago to try and, the housing, and I will say about the design of the building that was proposed several years ago, the residential building in the same area, it was much safer because of access. If you check the problems with high-density multifamily buildings, if people can get in to the building, then, in a way that where there's sort of shared access, like you have hallways and stuff like that, that allows them access. You get into a floor and there's 5 or 10 apartments on that floor, you've got access to all 10 of them. So you don't want to have something that allows public access into the building, which you're looking at if you're having a restaurant on the main floor, that will allow access to the other apartments. You're putting the people in the apartment buildings at a higher risk of being violated by crime. So there are a bunch of concerns here, and hopefully we can sit down. The residential aspect of this, wonderful. The more residential stuff you got in the neighborhood, that's better there is. And the other, I would look at some of the variances with respect if you're allowing a public use, commercial use in there. You know, you're doubling the density. You're allowing a restaurant of, what, about 2,500 square feet on the main floor? And you're cutting the parking required in half? Where are the people going to park who are coming to the restaurant? Doesn't make any sense. So hopefully we can work out something with this. But the housing proposal, way to go.
Okay. Thanks for your time, sir. Is there anybody who'd like to speak in opposition to the application for 456 Bannockine Avenue? Anybody require further information? No? Okay. Then we'll have the applicants come back up. Oh, yeah.
Take a second.
Oh, okay. Go ahead. Wait for a minute.
Oh, you were here.
They were here the whole time.
Yeah.
That's weird.
Here they are. I should have known that. Oh, those are opposition. No.
Yeah.
I just gave you those.
Okay. So did you guys fill out one of those forms?
You filled out forms like this?
Yeah.
Those aren't you.
No, that's not me.
You filled out a color form like that?
Yeah.
Not here.
Oh.
Okay.
Yeah, I will get some for you.
Could you
number six? Vanessa, can you turn it on? It's on? Okay, so I guess the first question I'm going to put is the patio. Now, you're showing tables and chairs and on the plan, but is that your intent to have an outdoor patio section?
Yeah, that is the intent.
Okay.
I'll speak to the concern about the safety. I won't comment on the criminal activity that goes on in restaurants.
Okay. Go ahead, please.
Let's not get into that. In terms of security, I mean, it's a proven fact that there's no better deterrent than eyes on the street. Like we, as an architect, we do this all the time. That's why planners and the city want activity at grade because of that, to deter certain activities from occurring when there's no one around, which that's what happens. When you don't have eyes on the street and it's hidden places or not well lit, that's what drives certain activities, like was said, empty sites, abandoned sites. That's when those certain activities happen. So by having eyes on the street and having somebody that actually uses the restaurant, whether it's, like we said before, the intent is for the tenants, but even if it's from the neighbors that come in and use it, having that visual connection to the street is, there's nothing better than, and obviously being lit at night, deterring certain activities from occurring in those locations. In terms of the entrance and the connection to being able to get into the building, this is a completely secure building. The entrance into the residence is completely separate than the restaurant. They're two separate entities. So to get into this building, there'll be a fob system. So unless you have a key to the building or somebody lets you in, you're not getting into the building. Likewise into the parking area. So in terms of secure that way, it's not a security concern. Other than somebody lets you in, then obviously you can avoid that. So in terms of the design for the patios, again, this was talked over with the planner, and the idea of creating those patios was exactly it. It was to bring activity to the street. That's how the whole concept came about, and that's how it was designed. It was to actually encourage activity on that street, not to actually deal away with it, and then having somebody else that doesn't live in the building coming and kind of making house out of that, or activities that shouldn't be happening in that area. So that's kind of the intent of the patios, is actually to contradict what's being suggested as what it's going to attract. Because I think if you have 26 units, they're all multi-tenant units, multi-bed units, and you're going to have certain movement of people coming in and out, that alone will deter activities from occurring in those spaces.
Okay, how about at midnight?
The tenants that we can see could be working nurses that have different shifts, so you're always going to have somebody coming in at different times. We're going to have cameras, we're going to have surveillance cameras. It's going to be well lit, as I said, like the entire two sidewalks on both streets are going to be completely lit. So whether it's night or day, if you're there, somebody's going to be seeing you, so the neighbors can see what's going on.
And part of this too, I understand the concerns with regarding the Tim Hortons, but this isn't going to be a 24-hour. Hour restaurant or coffee shop. I mean, this is going to be. It's going to have modest hours. It'll go into the night, and then it'll be lit from the inside, and the manager will be doing whatever he's doing past, but it won't be open to the public 24 hours like at Tim Hortons. And I understand at Catherine's point that there are things that were going on in that location, and there might be some in other decrepit buildings that are not too far away, or in a bathhouse. However, that speaks to the ownership and the management of the facility. That's nothing that we'd ever dream of tolerating. We're going to have a resident manager on site for the residential portion of this, which is going to be vigilant in what's going on this property as well. So I understand the concerns. And as Elio pointed out, there will be camera surveillance systems in the hallways as well, as the commercial area. And with no connection from one to the other, with having more, as Elio said, having more people on the streets, that neighborhood watch, the whole foundation of that is to put people out on the streets and to put a presence out there and have people so these type of things don't happen and people stay away from these areas, which I think we've done a good job in the initial design here and of addressing those concerns.
Okay. Anything else, Jim? That's it. That's all. Okay. Thank you for your time. Okay. This is Steve. Is this going to be it?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Okay. Concerning variance DAV 174104 2017 C 456 Bannatyne Avenue. Assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? And then Steve?
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor, post carry.
I move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor, post carry.
I move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan, does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway, is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property.
and is compatible with the area in which the property is to be affected is situated.
All in favor, opposed, carried.
I concur with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Okay, can you give us a little bit? We have people in opposition, so just give you your thoughts on how this would work.
Well, you're focused on a market of students from Red River Community College and the health sciences. You're looking at a younger tenant pool potentially. I do find the comments of the architect intriguing in terms of putting more feet and eyes on the street. That's basically some of the same premises as happening right now in terms of Portage and Main. I think that in terms of security, I think it's being well versed with cameras and having someone on site. So I think these are actually good things to see happening in the area. There's 24 potentially more residents in the area. 26. So for those reasons, I believe that it's in keeping with the area and it would be a good fit for the area.
Very good. Thank you.
I move that the recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be incurred in and the variance be approved subject to two conditions.
All in favor, opposed, carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor, opposed, carried.
Do you want to go back to the second condition, or do you want to amend it to include Brooks Elkirk West Condo?
Oh, right. We'd like to add a condition that the councillor would want the plan approval, is it? Mm-hmm. Go back to Lord Selkirk West Kildonan as the third condition.
Okay.
The third amending condition. The second condition.
Amending the second condition. Oh, yeah, because it's coming. We're supposed to go to them. Amending the second. Okay. As noted. All in favor?
Yeah.
Opposed, carried. And wrap it up, Steve?
No, you can.
Move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed, carried. Thank you.
Okay.
Can we go back to number six?
Yeah, that's to the condition. It's patiently sitting
Sorry.
There, everybody.
Item 6 is an application for a variance at 1095 Aaron Street under file DAB 168315 of 2017C. Members of the committee, please note there was communication received in support of the application after the agenda was published.
And could we have your names and address for the record, please?
My name is Cody Reimer. I'm with Crane Steel Structures at 5310 Monterey Road in Headingley.
And I'm Randy Eskelt from Refrigerator Supply at 1095 Aaron Street.
Okay, thank you. And we, as noted, we did have communication from an area resident in support of your application. And the city is, where are we? What are we up with here? Is recommending approval subject to one condition. Did you read that one condition?
Yes.
Yeah. Any issue or concerns with
that?
Any questions of the board at this time?
No.
Any questions of the applicant? Okay. As mentioned, we do have a couple of people here who have filed in opposition. So if you just want to give an idea of what you're asking for so they have a better understanding why you were here this evening.
So we are looking to build a new warehouse structure over an existing compound that they currently have on their property to shelter their product from the weather, vandalism, and theft. We are here applying for a variance to build an additional 10 feet into the 25-foot setback along Aaron Street.
And I believe that's going to be developed in accordance with the standards the city was requiring, which could be asphalt or concrete or with ornamental fencing and a hedge. Or am I on a different one?
No, you're on a different one.
On a different one?
That was Sargent, I think.
Oh, that was Sargent. You're right.
So
that's on Aaron.
Developed in substantial conformance with the plan submitted.
Right.
Asking that there's brick wrapping around so that it's attractive from the sides.
Okay. That's it?
There's more active street.
Okay.
There also was an ornamental fence in the front along Sargent, or sorry, along Aaron Street as well, with additional vegetation.
Okay.
And landscaping.
Okay. So what we'll do is have you gentlemen have a seat, and we'll listen to those in opposition. At this time, I'd like to ask if anybody else would like to speak in support of the application for 1095 Aaron. No? Okay, we'll go those in opposition. And first we have Richard Marshall.
Yes.
Yes, sir. And could we have your names and address for the record, please, gentlemen?
Sure. Richard Marshall, 1055 Aaron Street.
Thank you.
And Dom Costantini, 1055 Aaron Street.
Very good. Go ahead, gentlemen.
We brought some materials to share with the group here today to give a visual presentation of the impact of this development to our business and our property.
Okay.
wasn't aware.
So thank you very much for having us this evening. We represent approximately 70 employees who work at 1055 Aaron, which is Bird Construction. Our company's been in the city of Winnipeg since 1938. 1095 was Bird Construction and Bird Lumber from the 30s until the late 90s when it was sold and then developed for our neighbor. A couple of points that we want to bring up is that the development is not consistent with the block that we currently have our building on. The proposed development is approximately 27 feet tall. Most of the buildings are 16 feet high from grade. The other factor is that this will impact our business operations because our business will no longer be visible from Aaron Street or from Sargent Avenue. We are also currently looking at selling our property, and we've received appraisal values, and our commercial real estate partner has told us that our building will be reduced in value once this building is erected. The original compound had an ornamental fence that was approximately 6 feet off the ground. This is not a cover for just storage at 6 or 8 feet off the ground. We're talking 27 feet. It will block our view from the road as well and does have an impact on safety. The speed limit on Aaron is 60 kilometers an hour. We have developed drawings, so the first page shows that from the intersection to our entry is approximately 6.73 seconds of travel time from the intersection. We have, again, I restate, close to 70 employees that work in this building. We also close tenders for our clients. Tenders have to be delivered at 2 p.m. sharp. They cannot be late. So this will negatively impact our business. We have consultants, subcontract partners, suppliers that attend and visit our business. We also have 120 craft workers that work in the field that come every day for orientations and also come pick up checks and deliver timesheets. This is a big impact to our business. The second page here, you'll see this is the current view from Google Earth. And you can see our building at 1055 is not obstructed. The next page shows the proposed development, which is 14.5. And now that we've learned there's also ornamental fencing and additional landscaping, we will not be able to see the street at all. The third page shows it at a 25-foot setback, which is currently what is permitted. And we still are not pleased with what we see here. And we have never been consulted by this neighbor with regard to the development. We also would like to state that the piles have already been installed, even though the permit has not been obtained.
Yeah, they started construction about a month ago, actually about 2 months ago. And in fact, we assume that they probably found out that the variance was required after starting construction and applying for a building permit.
Page 5 of 15 shows the street view. And again, you can see our building from the corner. Page 6 shows the 25 and the 14.5 setback. We have no exposure at all from Aaron Street and Sargent. Page 7, that was what it looked like before they tore down the fence and started construction without a permit. Page 8 shows it at the various intervals. If you go back to the first page, it highlights different views. So there is at 310 feet, 249 feet, 165, and 125 feet. So again, it shows you the different perspectives from the street.
Yeah. So actually, if you look at view 2, where that's at, view 2 is 2 seconds away traveling on Aaron Street, which we want to point out is a one-way street, okay? That's 2 seconds away, so reaction time at 60 kilometers per hour is about 2 seconds, which means the people coming up Aaron Street won't be able to see our sign. All of a sudden, they'll see it. We're afraid they're going to slam on the brakes there and probably be rear-ended out in the street, okay?
Needless to say, there's about 50 cars that come through our neighbor's parking lot onto the street.
Now, we have the same impact on leaving, okay? Again, it's a one-way street. You can only go southbound. Okay. One of the sheets in here shows the view on leaving.
Page 11.
And, of course, you can only turn left, which means that you're that as soon as you start to turn, you're blind to the oncoming traffic. Okay. And that oncoming traffic isn't going to be able to see people turning out of our lot because the building's going to block the view. Okay. We see a very serious safety concern here. If the setback is allowed, there are going to be accidents happening. The only way that you can see, and I took my truck there yesterday to set to turn out, we would actually have to pull out with wheels on the sidewalk to be able to see the traffic around this, because the construction fence right now is mounted where they want this setback to be.
And the final shots rendering show the building as it would be viewed from our front entrance,
which would be a 27-foot high wall for the entire thing. So you're being asked to approve this. The planner is stating that it's consistent and doesn't create a substantial impact. This does create a substantial adverse effect on the use of our property. It will have a substantial adverse impact on the safety of our property, on the convenience and our use. Okay. You're being asked to say that it's not an injurious effect. If you look at the application that was submitted here, they're asking for an area that's 10.5 feet by 80 feet, which is 840 square feet. Out of the rest of this parking lot behind the 25-foot variance, there's almost 14,000 square feet that could be added onto. Okay, there's a lot of extra area within this lot where this is not needed. There is no injurious impact, okay, to this applicant. Okay. And then lastly, you're being asked to say that it's consistent with the area. It's totally and wholly inconsistent with the area. All the other buildings on our street are 16 foot tall. This is 28 foot tall. The other lots are narrow. This is a very wide lot. It's going to be approximately 6 or 8 times the volume of area facing the street and facing the residences across the street, okay, as all the rest of the buildings on the street.
They do have land on the Sargent side of this site, which they could develop that would not impact our business.
And they've got almost a third of an acre of property behind the existing 25-foot setback that can be developed. And yet they're asking for 840 square feet that will seriously impact our business.
So I've asked the city, there isn't any request for a variance for the height. So what's the height limitation in there? Is that 30 feet?
The height limitation, they can build to 50 feet.
They can build to 50 feet?
Yes.
Okay, so that's not an issue. And so the setback is the primary concern that you're having.
Well, we're not happy with either, but the setback is the main concern because there will be safety impacts. We will not be able to see our business from Aaron Street. We do private, closed, public tenders at our building. We have lots of people that visit us every day.
Yeah, we have people today, probably once a week, somebody comes into our lobby and states that they drove right past on the one-way street because they didn't see our sign. And right now there's a clear view all the way back to the intersection. If this setback is granted, 2 seconds, okay? 2 seconds away, you'll finally see the sign. If you happen to be looking for it, people are going to be driving by our business every single day. And we have, besides the 70 employees in our office, probably 200 visitors a day.
But earlier you mentioned that you're selling, right?
Well, potentially, that's what we're looking at, but we've already been advised that if this development does go through, our property value will be reduced.
And
the building is paid for clear and title by our company.
And besides the fact, if we sell it, it'll be a 16,000 square foot building that will have 100 employees of another company with the same problems and same concerns.
Okay. Anything else, gentlemen?
No.
Any questions of these gentlemen?
I just have a question. Yeah.
Yep.
You say the start of construction already?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you go into more detail?
About 2 months ago, they took the construction fence down. I watch it actually right outside of my office. We're wondering what's going on, and then they spent 4 days jackhammering out a concrete slab that was there that the air conditioning units used to sit on. Then they tore the fence down, and then about a month ago, probably 6 weeks ago, a layout crew came in and laid out for the piles, and then about 4 weeks ago, they installed the piles. At that point, we placed a call, and a stop work order was issued, and Workplace Health and Safety came out and made them put up a construction fence around it because we were worried about debris coming into our employee parking lot.
Plus public safety.
Yeah.
You could walk into the construction site from the city sidewalk.
Yeah.
That's not how you run a construction site.
Yeah.
We understand construction, public safety.
Yeah. Actually, I'll mention one other adverse impact, this 27-foot-high wall that's 4 feet away. There will be snow drifted up onto the roof, and quite often snow blows on the roof, and that snow will probably fall off right into our parking lot, onto the hoods of cars that are parked there.
Well, whether it's 16 feet or 100 feet, it's going to blow anyway, right? It is Winnipeg, and it's coming from the north, gentlemen. Okay. Good. Thanks for your time, gentlemen.
Now,
is there anybody else who'd like to speak in opposition to the application for 1095 Aaron or require further information? No? Okay. We can have Cody and Randy come back up. Okay, we can let's address the request for the setback. Okay, 14.5 instead of 25. And how dire is that requirement for you?
I can speak to it. It isn't. What we have done is our existing compound in the area, the configuration of our building, where they mentioned that you've got a lot of surface area to work from. The configuration of our building is somewhat L-shaped, and that's where our warehousing and our docking is. So it's a retail space that we've got into the front area that's not conducive to us to do a lot of warehousing on that side of the property. So that's why this effectively was an enclosure of what we had as an outdoor compound, where we stored a lot of our equipment that we had that is for sale into the marketplace. Due to the 4 to 5 months out of the year, it isn't good for the equipment itself to be out in that condition. It's not good for our people to be moving them around our forklifts. So essentially what we did was took the square footage of what our existing compound was that had been constructed 10 years ago.
Approximately.
And we just took the same square footage and we were going to enclose it to the height of our ceiling, existing ceiling height of our space. So that was what the plan was. And when we ended up finding out what the plans was, that there was a requirement for a variance to be able to use the same square footage that was existing previously with our compound area.
Okay. The building that's there right now, what's the height of the building, that building?
The existing building at the eave is 28 feet at the low side, and we are starting at 27 and then sloping it down to the street.
Oh. Okay. Okay. So,
I have a question for the city.
Yeah.
Looking at page 3, we've got an aerial view of Google Earth. It looks like, I don't know what direction it is, but south on Aaron. The properties are, the buildings are within that 25-foot setback. Do you know what the precedent is on that street for setbacks?
An average setback?
Yeah.
I don't know, but at a glance in Ivy, you can see that the setbacks are rather varied. So some of them look substantially smaller than that 25 feet. So at 10:49, 10:45, 10:41 in particular, and 10:35, they look substantially smaller. Ivy is not the best measuring tool, but it looks like some of them are as little as 5 feet from the property line.
Is this M zoning?
Yes.
That is it. Okay. I guess that was it. Did you have anything else?
No, I would just like to add that.
Well, you can only address what they were talked about. Okay.
Oh, okay. Sorry. Yeah. Sorry. I guess I do have a site view here. I know it was mentioned that they're going to lose the view of their building from Sargent Street.
Right.
This is just a shot from street view. Pass it around. What you can see of their building, if I just make points.
You can sit at the table, otherwise I can't, or your voice isn't recorded, sorry.
Sorry. First time here.
No. Yeah. Okay, yeah.
So there's not very much that's already visible above the fence line, and typically when product is stored, your product is stacked about 12 feet high?
No, it can go as high as, based on the manufacturer's allowance, it could be 5 to 6 units, and they can be anywhere from 3 to 4 feet high per piece. So we can go as high as 20 feet with them. This is just a yard for inventory in our product.
Right.
There was a mention of that there was air conditioners that were there on a concrete pad. It's an asphalt compound area, and the air conditioners are our product that we brought in for resale. So they're not affixed to the actual, to a pad or to the building itself, and they're not usable in a building. And it can vary as to how high that we stack them based on the piece of equipment that it is and how many that we have in inventory. At some times, we're almost full to the full height of the, alongside that one wall to the full height, so it's almost 25 feet.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
Concerning variance DAV 171510 2017 C47. Oh, nope, that's not right. I'm sorry. Concerning variance DAV 168315 2017 C 1095 Aaron. Assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board? It'll be Vanessa.
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
That the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
That in accordance with subsection 247 sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is a minimum modification of the zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report and note that there's precedent on the street for reduced setbacks.
Okay, thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved subject to two conditions.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be completed.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried. Actually, I think it's one condition.
Yeah.
I think there's one condition on this.
Okay, there's just one.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. So the board has agreed with the recommendation of the city, but as I mentioned before, these are decisions are appealable. That information will be forthcoming to all those registered. And thank you for your patience, especially gentlemen.
Item 14 is an application for a variance at 470 William Avenue under file 171510 of 2017C.
And your name and address, please, sir.
Name is Mansoor Hussain, and I'm here for 470 William.
Okay, and you live at 3 Shipley?
3 Shipley Court, Winnipeg, okay. Manitoba.
Okay, the city is recommending approval subject to two conditions. Have you read those conditions?
Yes, sir.
Have any issues or concerns?
No. What I understood is that if I understood it correctly, because the language was very technical,
yeah.
The first condition is that the planning division wants a caveat registered.
A right of passage, I guess, for access.
Right of access.
Yeah, exactly.
So I agree with that.
And I believe you own that property, too.
I own both properties.
Right.
And I would definitely register some kind of caveat or whatever my lawyer would draft it.
Right.
In case I sell the property, that would continue.
Correct.
And give the new owner an unconditional, perpetual access to the parking lot. I have no problem with that.
Okay, that's good. And the second one, that the owner must submit plans showing the location design, right?
Yes.
Okay, that's all good then?
Yes, all good.
Any questions of the board?
No.
Any questions of the applicant?
No. I have one question.
Okay.
Since you own both lots, why wouldn't you consolidate them?
The lot I'm going to build is at the corner of Harriet and William. The building I already own is 129 Isabel. Now, if we consolidate and don't take the new address, for example, then it is really odd for someone to find the other units of 129 Isabel, which are not physically attached with 129 Isabel, and they are actually detached and at the corner of Harriet and William, number one. And number two, I'm not consolidating because right now I don't have any plan to sell it. 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, maybe I do like to sell it. And that's why I wanted to keep the both titles separate.
Can one title have different civic addresses, though, on different streets?
Well, they call them convenience addresses, but they're not legal. Mm-hmm. They're used for taxation. Okay.
I just have, and I didn't have time to look into this too much, but I have concerns where you're registering a caveat where the same owner owns both lands. I think they can only register by way of a caveat, which can be discharged easily. Is there anything that regulates? Once they've registered it, they meet the conditions.
Yeah. And they can withdraw. May I say something in this regard? Even from the business point of view, if I don't guarantee the new owner that unconditional, perpetual, legally bound access, I won't be able to get full price of that property.
But if you sold the other property.
It's same thing. If I sold the other, then I would like, and I, like, for example, I sell 129 Isabel and like to keep 470 William, then I would like to keep that right for myself. An unconditional perpetual access to that building.
And you may, but what about in the future? That's my concern. Mm-hmm. How does the city address that?
You're correct in that it is a private agreement, typically between two different property owners. So we don't have any authority over whether it's discharged or not.
Then what is the need for it?
I guess there is the interest in the future. I guess in some ways the intent has been stated. While legally this may be not as strong as we would like, it is a circumstance in that it is an unusual lot, and it's a lot that's been there for a long time, without any access of its own. So it's a unique situation, and we're open to facilitating the project.
It's not landlocked, so I'm not opposed to it, but I just know that this mm-hmm. can't really bind the land forever, yeah. Even if that's every month in camp currently. But there's always access to the building. It just may not have the curb cut
or access. Yeah. Unless it has that agreement in place.
Correct. Okay. You okay with this?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Is there anybody else like to speak in support of the application for 470 William? Speak in opposition or require further information? Okay. Thank you. This will be Steve's, I guess. Mm-hmm. Concerning variance DAV 17151 2017C 470 William Avenue, assuming all statutory requirements in regards to this application have been complied with, what is the will of the board?
I move that the report of the Winnipeg Public Service be taken as read.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
Move that the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I move that in accordance with subsection 2473 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. Does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities, use, safety, convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway, is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property to be affected is situated.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I concur with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendations of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in, and that the variance be approved subject to one condition.
I think there's two on this one.
Mm-hmm.
Two?
Two conditions, yes.
All in favor? Both carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Both carried.
Thank you very much.
There's one here for item 10 that was signed in. I don't believe. Sorry, yeah, item 10, 669 Magnus.
Yeah. Gentlemen, which property are you here for?
669.
There we go. Right. Are you the applicants?
Yes.
Did you fill out some forms?
Yes.
Do you have these forms?
Ah. Come on up, please.
Could you fill it out, completely with your name and right here? Yeah, put your name down if you print. Thank you. Michael, it's your last name. You got to put it on this line.
Here, we're going to put it here?
No, right here on this line. Perfect, thank you.
Okay. Do we have your name and address for record, please, sir?
Michael Hegos, 251 Toronto Street.
Thank you. And this is for number 10. The city is recommending approval subject to three conditions. Have you read those conditions?
Yes.
Have you any issues or concerns?
No.
No? Any questions of this board?
Not really.
No. Sorry?
No.
No? Okay. Any questions of the applicant? No. Is there anybody else like to speak in support of the application for 669 Magnus? Speak in opposition or require further information? No? Okay. Thank you, sir. Concerning variance DAV 172789-2017C-669 Magnus Avenue, assuming all statutory requirements regarding this application have been complied, what is the will of the board? And it'll be Vanessa. All in favor, opposed, carried.
With the receipt of public representations be concluded.
All in favor, opposed, carried.
Then in accordance with subsection 247 sub 3 of the City of Winnipeg Charter, the variance is consistent with Plan Winnipeg and any applicable secondary plan. It does not create a substantial adverse effect on the amenities use, safety, and convenience of the adjoining property and adjacent area, including an area separated from the property by a street or waterway. It is a minimum modification of a zoning bylaw required to relieve the injurious effect of the zoning bylaw on the applicant's property, and is compatible with the area in which the property could be affected or situated.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I agree with the comments contained in the planner's report.
Thank you.
I move that the recommendation of the Winnipeg Public Service be concurred in and the variance be approved subject to three conditions.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried.
I move that the public hearing with respect to this application be concluded.
All in favor? Opposed? Carried. And I think that's that it.
Yeah, just want to comment that in front of you is the 2018 Board of Adjustment dates.
Very good.
For the members.
Thank you. Motion to adjourn. Vanessa, thank you.